Welcome to this class about dynamic programming. In a previous class, I have defined Markov decision processes, or MDPs, as a context where an agent is interacting with an environment and is looking for the optimal policy in this environment. Actually, dynamic programming methods are methods to find this optimal policy. The point is that to use dynamic programming methods, you have to assume that the agent knows everything about the MDP. So in particular, it knows the transition and reward function. By contrast, we will see in the next class that reinforcement learning applies when the transition and reward functions are unknown. And now to define dynamic programming method, I will have to introduce a mathematical construct which is called the value function. So what's the value function? First, consider the policy on the left here. You have some maze, you assume that there is some reward on that particular cell, and the policy is driving you to that particular cell. So what's the value function? When you are in a particular state, for instance here, the value function will tell you what is the value of being in that state and then following the policy which is defined here. So we note it V pi because it's dependent on the policy pi and it records the aggregation of reward that the agent will consider on the long run for each state if it follows that particular policy. And you have to be aware that that particular value function is a vector with one entry per state. Okay, you have one value here, etc. By contrast, the action value function is something more complicated. It's a matrix. So we define it with q pi, and it tells you the value of being in that particular state, for instance here, doing that particular action, and then following policy pi. But you could do an action which is different from the policy here. For instance, you could say what is the value of being there, going there, and then following policy pi. So to make it more clear, I have taken those four states, S0 to S3 here, and then I have told you what is the value of, for instance, being in S0 and going north. It's just the same value because you don't move. But if you go east, you can see that the value is greater. Okay. And if you go south, you can see that the value is lower because you are moving away from the reward. Okay. So using the Q function, you can determine what you should do just by looking for the best value among the potential actions in your particular state. For instance, if you are in S1, the good idea is to go east too. Okay? Okay, so this Q function or action value function is a matrix which tells you what is the value of taking one particular action in a particular state. So you have one entry per state and per value. Okay? So that's more complicated than the value function. And in the remainder, I will focus on the V function and I will just tell you, okay, you have to be aware that it's trivial to transpose from value functions to action value functions, so from V to Q. Okay? So how do we compute the value of following a particular policy? So assume an agent which was in state S0, it performed that action, and then it was at that state, that action, etc., etc. So that's the trajectory of an agent. And I assume I am discounting the value from that particular state to that, the reward from that particular state to that particular state, as I explained to you when defining Markov decision processes. Okay? So what's the value of being in S1? That's R1. Plus gamma times R2 plus gamma squared times R3 plus gamma at the power 3 gamma times R4, etc., etc. And what's the value of S0? That's R0 plus gamma times R1 plus gamma squared times R2 plus gamma to the power 3 times R3, etc. Okay. So if you look more closely, in fact, the value of S0 is R0 plus gamma times the value of R1. Okay. Because you just multiplied all the following terms by gamma once more. Okay? So more generally, than, beyond this example, you will have that if ST plus 1 follows ST, the value of ST will be the local reward plus gamma times the value of st plus 1. So that's a recursive relation which will be very useful to compute values in MDPs. So that's the case along a trajectory. Now, let's consider a full MDP, so an agent that follows many different trajectories. So what's the, how do we generalize this formula to the all potential trajectories? So to perform this generalization, we have to consider the expectation of following the different trajectories. Okay, and the expectation of the random variable is the sum of the realization weighted by their probabilities. You have to know this notion of expectation if you want to understand something about Markov decision processes. Okay, and to put here, the different realizations are the potential next states. So they may depend on stochastic probability of transitions between a state and a next state given a particular action. So how do you generalize this formula to the case where you consider expectation? In fact, in the case of a deterministic policy, you get that particular formula. So the value of being in that state is the reward for taking a particular action, so for instance here A0, okay, plus gamma times the sum over all probabilities of moving to that particular state times the value of the particular state. Okay, so if you have a greater probability of moving in S2, the value of S2 will be more important in determining the value of A0. That's quite logical if you consider this. And then for a stochastic policy, you get a slightly different formula because you have to consider the probability of taking an action given a state. So that's more or less the same idea, but instead of having P of S, you have the probability of A given the state. But that's the same. Okay? So look closely at this formula. It tells you that the value of a state will be the immediate reward plus gamma times the sum over the different probabilities of transitions times the value. You will see this again many times because this will allow us to define what we call Bellman operators. So to understand dynamic programming, you have to know a very important mathematical property, the property of some recursive operators about convergence. So the idea is that if we define an operator T such that if we apply T to Xn, we get Xn plus 1. The important property is that if T is contractive, then through repeated application of T, Xn will converge to some fixed point. Okay. For instance, if your operator T is division by 2, then whatever the initial value x0, this will converge to 0 because every time you will divide the next value by 2. Okay. So division by 2 is a contractive operator. The point is that the Bellman operators that I will now define are contractive, so they will converge to something when they are applied to a value function. So remember, this was the operator that I have told you about. So first we can define an algorithm called value iteration by defining a Bellman optimality operator, which takes this formula and then takes the max over actions to apply that particular formula. So if I compute my next value by taking the max action and then computing the best action and then computing the value through what is called the Bellman backup, so the propagation of value to the next state, then we can show quite easily that if gamma is lesser than 1, then this operator is contractive. And we can show that this is shown in the Puterman book, that the optimal value function is a fixed point of this Bellman optimality operator. So we get V star is the fixed point of T star. Okay, and just by applying T star repeatedly to an initial value function, then you will converge to the optimal value function. Okay. A different operator is defined as more simply the Bellman operator. That's the one that I have shown you. That's the Bellman backup again. Here you don't have the max operator. And also the Bellman operator is contractive. So by applying policy iteration to the value function, you will converge to an optimal value and also find an optimal policy. So policy iteration is more complicated than value iteration. It's in two steps. You have one step of policy evaluation where you apply the Bellman operator corresponding to the current policy to compute the value of the current policy. And then you improve the policy just by taking the better action given the current value function. Okay. You have two different formula here because you have some mathematical identity that I won't detail here. Okay. So you will compute the value of a policy, then improve your policy, compute the value again, improve your policy, etc. And this is shown to converge also to the optimal value and policy. Okay. So now let's have a look, a closer look at the algorithms themselves. So I have taken the presentation of these algorithms from the Sutton and Bartow book. Okay. And value iteration is very simple. You just have one loop where you just compute the value of a current state, then you maximize, then you apply the Bellman operator with the max here, and you do so until the difference between the previous values and the new values are inferior to some threshold. And if it's inferior to the threshold, you can stop. You have reached the optimal value function. Okay? Very simple. You will implement this in labs if you are one of my students. So how does it work in practice? So let's take again this simple maze with some reward here. I will apply this operator so everywhere. Okay. So if I am here and I'm looking for the best place where I can go, in fact the value everywhere around is zero. So gamma times the sums of values of the following states is just zero. The immediate reward is zero too. So just by applying this operator here or here or here everywhere, nothing happens. Just but there, because here I have one state for which the value is 1. So if I apply gamma times this, it will be 0 in that direction, but it will be 1 in that direction. So times gamma, it will be 0.9. And after one iteration, nothing has changed anywhere but there, because here gamma times this is 0.9. So I have changed this value. So after one iteration, this is what I obtain. After a second iteration, then the value of this one is 0.9 times the value of this one, 0.9, so it's 0.81. After a third iteration, here I have 0.9 times 0.81, so that's 0.729 that I have rounded up, okay? And so on, and so on, and you can see that little by little the value propagates everywhere until you get the value function corresponding to the optimal policy. Okay. In fact, here we take the best action, so this corresponds to the value function of the optimal policy. And then I can get this optimal policy just by moving up to the closest, to the best value around, and this will define that particular policy. Okay, that's just doing hill climbing around those values. So we have just iterated on values without taking care of the policy. Okay, and finally we determine the policy out of those values without using Q of SA. I could do the same with Q of SA, but that's not what I do in this class. Okay. Now let's have a look at policy iteration. At the first glance, you can see that it's more complicated. In fact, you have two main parts. One is policy evaluation. It's very similar to value iteration, in fact, okay, but you don't have the max here, okay. And then you have policy improvement, where you maximize the policy by taking the best of the actions round, okay. And how does it work in practice? So in policy iteration, you start by having some policy, so you need some initial policy. Here I have taken that particular policy. Okay, and I have shown it in the corresponding value function. So you can see that here, if you are anywhere here, you will end up there in that particular loop. Okay, and this brings no value. So in fact, the value is zero. But if you are here, then you move towards the reward. So you get the corresponding values. So what can you do? You can see that here you could improve your policy just by changing that particular arrow to there. Okay, so that's what we do in the next step. And this defines a new policy. Okay, the new policy has all the blue arrows, the green one, not the red one was removed, and then the blue ones. Okay, and then we will compute the value of this policy again. That's what we get, because from here now we move to there. Okay, so that's better. Okay, but we can still improve this policy, because here the values are not good. So we could move that particular arrow to here and that particular arrow to here. Okay, that's what we do. We compute the values again. That's better, but there is still some improvement there. So we change the arrows here. Okay, we compute the values again. But now moving from here to here is not a good idea. In fact, the value here is better. So we should change again the policy here. Okay, and then we have to change it again here. Okay, and finally we are done. And we found the exactly same optimal policy as before. But the process was more complicated. We changed the policy, then the value, then the policy, then the value, etc., etc. Okay. Finally, I have presented to you two ways to perform dynamic programming. One was called value iteration, and the other one was called policy iteration. And in policy iteration, what you do in principle is that you evaluate each policy up to convergence, and then you change your policy, and then you evaluate it again, and then you change your policy, and then you evaluate it again, etc., etc. But policy evaluation is slow, okay? So the policy iteration process can be rather slow. Instead, in fact, we can show that we can evaluate the policy just for n iterations, or even not for all states. We can just change the evaluation of one particular state and then improve your policy, and then change the evaluation of one state and then improve the policy, etc., etc. We can do anything between just changing the value of one state and completely reevaluating the policy. Okay, this leads to a view which is called asynchronous dynamic programming, where we decouple policy evaluation and policy improvement. Okay, so we have one process that evaluates the policy, we have one process that improves the policy corresponding to the evaluation, and those two processes don't need to be synchronized. And this, what this diagram shows is that here you move towards better evaluating the policy, either you move towards improving the policy, and any path between those two will converge finally to the optimal value and the optimal policy. Okay, so a word to say that if you are one of my students, you will have to implement value iteration with the V and Q functions, also implement policy iteration with the V and Q functions, and then compare them. And optionally, you could also study the generalized policy iteration algorithm. So if you have any questions, don't hesitate to reach me by this email address. Thank you for listening.